I think it's safe to say that most of you out there are very familiar with either Windows or Mac operating systems, and chances are you've used one or the other almost exclusively your whole life without considering all the other options out there. You might have heard of like Linux, but don't really know much about it. For example, did you know that there is no such thing as just a pure operating system called Linux? Well, in this video, you won't have to wonder any more about what else is out there because we're gonna go through it all and break it down for you and hopefully make it easy to understand. Because yes, there are a ton of other operating systems out there besides just Windows and Mac, but it's not really as complicated as you might imagine. Now, quickly, before we begin, I wanna give a big thanks to the sponsor of this video, Squarespace. If you need anything from a domain to a website or an online store, you can make your next move with Squarespace. Squarespace is an all-in-one platform, so you'll never have to worry about installing or upgrading anything, making it easy to, for example, create an online store using award-winning templates where you can even manage inventory and orders. Of course, if you want, you can also set up or transfer your domain through Squarespace if you already have one. You can start your free trial today at squarespace.com and go to squarespace.com/theojoe to get 10% off your first purchase, and that link will be in the description as well. So now, let's go over those operating systems. And yes, you could just skip through and look at the list of the OSs I mentioned, but I really encourage you to watch the whole thing to understand the context of why you might actually use each one. To most easily understand how current operating systems relate to each other, we need to go way back to when we had DOS, Disk Operating System. Well, actually, DOS is irrelevant now, so we're just gonna skip past that and begin in 1969. This is when we got the first big daddy of operating systems still around today, and it had an essential part of what we're gonna be talking about, so bear with me. And this OS was called UNIX. UNIX was originally created at AT&T as an operating system for use in their Bell system, but eventually AT&T started licensing out the operating system to third parties. Today, there really isn't any pure UNIX operating system left. Instead, UNIX is a family of operating systems that all must adhere to a proprietary specifications list called the Single UNIX Specification in order to be considered a true UNIX OS. So it's more of a brand as opposed to an actual OS. Many of you at this point might be thinking, yeah, well, how many people really even use UNIX? Well, you might be surprised that there's at least one very popular operating system that is indeed a true UNIX OS. And do you know what it is? It's Mac. Yes, Mac OS is one of the many flavors of UNIX. So hopefully you see why I needed to explain all that backstory, and it will become even more important soon. Though, besides Mac, there really isn't any other UNIX operating system we'd be interested in, because any others would mostly be used for enterprise systems like servers, supercomputers, mainframes, and that sort of thing. And I just want to focus on the ones that we can actually use. So if you were to ask anyone to name a desktop operating system besides Windows or Mac, probably everyone would say Linux. But as I mentioned before, there is no actual operating system you can just download and install called Linux, because that just refers to the Linux kernel. Now hold on, if you have no idea what I'm talking about, let me explain. The kernel of an operating system is basically like its core. The kernel is what directly interacts with the hardware of the computer, such as the CPU and RAM, and allows them to interact with any applications. It's essentially the main bridge between the hardware and software. So anytime a program is running on your computer, the kernel is what passes anything to and from the CPU so it can actually run. So as you can imagine, there can be many varieties of Linux operating systems called distributions or distros, all using the same Linux kernel. Oh, and if you're wondering if it's a coincidence that Linux sounds a lot like UNIX, it's not. The Linux kernel was heavily inspired by UNIX, you might say, and was written by a guy named Linus Torvalds. And Linus named it by combining his name with UNIX, resulting in Linux. This is why you may have heard Linux referred to as a UNIX-like operating system. It's very similar, but not exactly the same. Okay, enough of the history lesson. We haven't even talked about any other operating systems you guys can use yourself. Well, there is one more family of operating systems we'll talk about afterwards, but for now, let's go over some popular Linux distros. If you're aware of any Linux distros at all, then you've probably at least heard of Ubuntu. It's one of the many free Linux distros, and it has been heavily marketed towards more casual mainstream users. You might even call it the Mac of Linux. I just came up with that, you don't have to use that. If you've never used a Linux operating system before, you'll probably be pleasantly surprised to find out the visual experience, at least, isn't too much different from what you're used to. Of course, under the hood, things do get significantly more complicated, and you're often left having to get your hands dirty, and you'll probably definitely have to use the terminal a lot. Anyway, then there's also the Debian OS, which Ubuntu is actually a derivative of. Debian has an enormous catalog of software in what are known as official repositories, so any distros based on Debian can also use this catalog to easily install almost any program automatically. Debian's website describes itself as the universal operating system, and one of the main selling points is that it apparently wants to support a wide range of hardware and users in as many levels of experience as possible. Though it's still probably not as easy to use as Ubuntu. Then there's another popular one called Linux Mint, which is a derivative of Ubuntu. So we're all going back to Debian at the beginning again. And even though it is based off Ubuntu, it differs in a lot of ways. For example, Mint's user interface will remind you a lot more of Windows, whereas Ubuntu is closer to Mac, I guess. But even though Mint is more familiar visually, a lot of people still find Ubuntu easier to use once they figure out the basics of navigating it. The Ubuntu versus Mint debate is a heated one, so I don't think you can say that one is necessarily better than the other, but Mint might actually end up being better for those who are a bit more tech savvy in the first place. Another well-known distro you may have heard of is called Fedora, which, like Debian, is one of the major branches of Linux that many distros are based on. This one's updated very frequently, and it's considered bleeding edge, so in terms of new innovation, Fedora is probably where things will show up first. One interesting thing about Fedora is that it requires all software in its official repositories to be free. This can be a good or bad thing depending on how you look at it. There is nothing stopping you from installing proprietary software, but you'll have to go out of your way a bit to get it. It's not like it's a difficult operating system, but it's definitely not good for the average consumer who can barely even work Windows. And the final Linux distro we can mention is CentOS, which is focused on enterprise use. And this one is also part of the Fedora family. It was made pretty much just to be a free version of another distro, Red Hat Enterprise Linux. So you'd expect this to be used a lot in business environments, servers, and commercial settings. The main difference between CentOS and Red Hat Enterprise is that Red Hat has paid support, which might obviously be very useful if it's used in a business. So those are all just a small handful of Linux distros in only two major families, Debian and Fedora, but there are literally hundreds of other distros out there. All right, now we've talked about Unix and Linux, but there is one more set of operating systems that we need to cover, and that is BSD, or Berkeley Software Distribution. And like Linux, BSD is also a derivative of Unix. However, BSD is much more closely related to Unix than Linux, because BSD was created using the original Unix code. Another difference from Linux is that BSD is not just a kernel, but had been created as a complete operating system. Now, just like Unix itself, there isn't a single official BSD. The operating system, simply known as BSD, stopped development many years ago, and several branches came off of it. The three most widely used today are called FreeBSD, OpenBSD, and NetBSD. And even though one is called FreeSB, all of them are actually free. BSD distros in general are not for the faint of heart, and it really isn't on par with Linux in terms of user friendliness. However, BSD is usually considered much more robust and reliable. So for the most part, these are usually used for servers as opposed to desktop. The only exception would be the distro called TrueOS, which is a derivative of FreeBSD and was specifically made as a desktop OS. And there are a lot of overlap between the different BSD distros, but there are differences. In general, FreeBSD focuses on use in servers and to some extent desktops. Like I said, because BSD is extremely reliable and scales well, you'll usually see it on high-end servers and those that have to handle a lot of traffic. then NetBSD is made to work on as many platforms and devices as possible, and this even includes toasters, literally. So anything from AMD 64, i386, ARM, and a ton of other architectures. OpenBSD, on the other hand, focuses on maximum security. In fact, it's regarded as the most secure operating system currently available, because it was created from the start with that purpose. So typically you'll see OpenBSD running on internet-facing devices such as firewalls, routers, VPN gateways, you get the idea. Of course, don't just assume that because you install it that you can't get hacked. OpenBSD requires a lot of knowledge to configure correctly to be secure, and if you don't know what you're doing, you might not be as safe as you think. So now we've gone over several operating system choices that you have. For beginners, the easiest choice would probably be Ubuntu, but if you're willing to do a little bit more tweaking, you can go with Linux Mint. Debian is what those are based off of, so that is another choice, but maybe after you've played around with the others a little bit. If you consider yourself pretty tech savvy and aren't afraid to get your hands dirty, you could go with Fedora if you want to be on the cutting edge. And if you think you could benefit from a more business-oriented OS, especially for a server, you might look into CentOS. Of course, many distros, including Ubuntu, also do have server versions. If you really want to get in the trenches, you could go with a BSD distro. I personally would want to get familiar with something like Linux first, because it will get you used to configuring things yourself a bit more often. FreeBSD is probably a good place to start, or better yet, perhaps TrueOS for a desktop. NetBSD and OpenBSD are an option, but I don't think it would make sense to install either of those unless you had a specific reason to do so. So with all that, I'm gonna hope you at least learned a thing or two, or maybe you never heard of any of these, who knows? You can let me know down in the comments, I'd love to hear from you. If you wanna keep watching, I'll put some other videos right here, you can just click on those. And if you wanna subscribe, I make a few new videos every week. And also consider enabling notifications as well. Otherwise, YouTube literally won't even show you the new videos at all anyway. So as usual, thanks so much for watching, guys. I'll see you next time. Have a good one.